I think of the traditional model of business as a pipeline model where you keep creating product or service, you push it out and it goes to the market. And it's a linear flow of value. Whereas in a platform business, you enable this multi-directional flow of value where different parties connect to you and exchange value with each other.
Welcome to Prime Venture Partners Podcast, a podcast for entrepreneurs looking to build and grow their startups. Learn about uncommon strategies and common traps from makers and doers of startup ecosystem.
Welcome to the Prime Venture Partners Podcast. Today we have with us a special guest, Sangeet Paul Chaudhary. Sangeet is the founder of Platformation Labs and is a C-level advisor to many Fortune 500 companies across the globe. He is a strategic thinker and a best-selling author. I have read a couple of his books, Platform Revolution and Platform Scale, and we'll talk about that. And most recently, wanted to congratulate him for becoming the youngest ever recipient of the IIM Bangalore's Distinguished Alumnus Award. Welcome to the podcast, Sangeet.
Thanks, Amit. Really glad to be here. Thank you.
So, Sangeet, you've become very well known for your work on platform thinking and, you know, this transition over the last decade or more around from pipes to platforms. Can you just give people just a basic understanding of what platforms are and how you think about them?
Yeah, so I believe that as the world has been getting more connected, especially since the rise of the smartphone, and as we start seeing consumers and businesses generate more data, we are moving to a new business model, which I think of as the platform business model, where you connect multiple different parties, producers and consumers of value, and enable them to exchange value with each other. And that's the business essentially, then the business model of connecting these sites with each other rather than simply creating products and services itself. And so to distinguish this from the traditional model of business, I think of the traditional model of business as a pipeline model where you keep creating product or service, you push it out and it goes to the market. And it's a linear flow of value. Whereas in a platform business, you enable this multi-directional flow of value where different parties connect to you and exchange value with each other. And this is, I believe, the key shift that we've seen over the last decade, where platforms have taken center stage. The leading companies in the S&P 500 are platforms. Traditional businesses are moving towards platforms. And just to put some more clarity around these concepts, when you think of platforms, we're talking about social networks, marketplaces, like social networks like Facebook or YouTube, or marketplaces like Airbnb, you know, Amazon Marketplace for that example. But it's now extending more broadly across industries. If you think of healthcare, platform businesses are coming up over there. Banks are thinking of transitioning to platform style businesses. So I'm happy to discuss all this in more detail, but I just wanted to paint that broad picture to start with.
That sounds great. So a lot of our audience members are startups, and often early stage startups, maybe some even growth stage startups. And you know, I have a point of view that, hey, platforms, you know, evolve, and you don't as a startup go and say, I'm going to build a platform, right? You have to go solve problems and use cases that matter to a variety of folks. Of course, you could have an architecture. How do you think about it in the context of startups as opposed to perhaps larger companies in terms of how they should think about platforms? And then we can take a specific example maybe, but why don't you start with how should startups think about platforms?
I guess all business starts with solving a pain point, right? And so that does not change whether you are a pipeline or a platform business model, which is the logic of how value gets created and delivered, comes as a second step once you've determined what pain point you're trying to solve. So it starts with solving a pain point. And the point at which you start thinking about a platform business is where you start thinking, what's the right way to solve this pain point? Do I create the value and bring it to the end user? Do I connect multiple sites so that they've discovered each other? Am I trying to help provide an infrastructure to a certain kind of customer to upskill themselves, or am I helping them connect to a new market? When you start getting into those nuances, then you start thinking about, well, a platform is a better solution than a traditional product or service model. I'm not a strong advocate of, you know, the idea of let's build the Uber for X or the Shopify for Y. You have to start with the pain point and then determine what is the best way to solve it. And given the fact that there are many use cases which are better solved by being an enabler and connecting different parties rather than by providing the value yourself, that's where platforms start becoming important. So I would still start with the pain point. And in some cases, your initial iteration itself might be a platform because you just are in a market where you do not where you cannot be the product or service provider. And in some other cases, you could start as a product creator and then transition it into a platform business. So again, you start with the pain point and then move from there.
Sounds good. We'll come back to startups back a little bit later on the podcast. You define three attributes or sort of framework or a framework that defines a platform, right? So there's marketplaces or community, there is infrastructure, there is data as three key attributes, right? So maybe let's take an example, right? Zoom is all the rage now. In fact, we're recording this podcast on Zoom.
Sure.
How does something like Zoom come about? You know, when things like WebEx and Skype and Google Hangout and so many other things exist. Again, partly to illustrate the framework and partly to think about, say, Zoom in the context of it being a platform company.
Yeah, so I would say that Zoom started out very much as an infrastructure provider, an infrastructure for having these discussions, right? So I'm using the term infrastructure in the form of a tool over here. So Zoom provided a tool for video meetings and conference and, you know, interactions. And from there, it started layering on other layers, so to speak. At this point, I would still say it's a tool-heavy business which has not fully transitioned into a platform business, but points at which it started opening up are interesting. One is, of course, in terms of integrations. So there are third-party integrations you can integrate into Zoom. That's still, you know, extending the infrastructure or tools layer of the overall business model. Then there is network or community elements that are being brought in, which could range from how access control is managed in the future. Data would start playing a bigger role. For example, if Zoom can figure out if you're Zoom bombing on a regular basis, or if you're a high-risk candidate, you just automatically have lower access and decision rights on the platform as you move forward. So I would expect that as we move forward, it would largely remain a tool-oriented, infrastructure-heavy platform rather than a network-heavy and a data-heavy platform. So again, if I compare it, Shopify, for example, is again an infrastructure-heavy platform versus an Amazon, which is a network and data-heavy platform. And similarly, in the video side of things, I would say, Zoom is infrastructure-heavy, TikTok is very data-heavy and network-heavy. They are solving different problems, no doubt. My point is that you can have platforms in many different configurations, as these examples illustrate.
So would you put something like Houseparty as a network or community-heavy kind of video interaction platform?
Yeah, I would say that with the disclaimer at this point that I have myself not used Houseparty as such. I've just read extensively about it, but I would put that more in the network-heavy model.
Sounds great. So let's talk about the, you know, your latest blog post, which actually triggered me reaching out to you.
Sure. So I've started exploring this series of ideas around how does business change in a post-COVID-19 world, right? And there are multiple elements of how that change gets manifested. There's change in consumer use cases. There's, because of consumer use cases changing, there's going to be change in how processes are structured around consumers, how supply chains are structured, and eventually how underlying infrastructure shifts start happening on the basis of that. So with that whole framework for where things are headed, I've started to get into identifying what are the core shifts in how business models will change, and in particular, how does that impact platform businesses, but also all other businesses, how does that impact from a perspective of an opportunity to create a new business model? And if you think of things broadly as pipelines and platforms, every pipeline has an opportunity to think of a platform business. Every platform has an opportunity to strengthen itself with more pipeline elements, which I can share about later as well. But that's where I'm going with these blog posts and these newsletters at this point. I'm happy to dig deeper into some of these ideas.
Sure. So let's talk about one which we were talking about earlier before the podcast, right? Which is, what are some unique opportunities you think for people to rethink their models, business models, systems, strategies in a post-COVID-19 world, right? Because we see that there's lots of opportunity. Of course, there's lots of downsides and people have talked a lot about that. Maybe you could take a couple of examples and talk about what some of the new things that would emerge beyond just Zoom meetings and house party kind of stuff.
Right. So let's think of opportunities at least three different levels, right? So the first is opportunities because of change in consumer behavior. And the reason I think that is important is because I think the right way to think about the current crisis, COVID-19, is not to think of it as a disruption to business, but as an extended social conditioning phase where consumers are being conditioned towards new use cases. So if you're the business who can identify those new use cases earlier, you are well positioned to emerge in a post-COVID world with a strong business model. So let's dig a little deeper into consumer use cases. The second thing I would look at is value chain shifts, right? Because when consumer use cases change, they don't just impact a particular product or business model, they impact the negotiating power in the value chain. And I'll give a few examples of that, which I believe are happening right now. And the third thing then is, what are the upstream, what's the upstream impact? What are the infrastructural shifts that would start happening and which are largely driven by some of these horizontal consumer use cases? And there's a reason for, you know, these infrastructural shifts happening around crisis moments. If you think of it, you know, a lot of technology shifts have happened around crises, and they have not been coincidences. So if you think of the shift to mobile happened around the previous recession, 2008-2009. The shift to smartphones and, you know, to really mobile in the enterprise. The shift to web in a big way happened post the dot-com bust and post 9/11. And similarly, client-server architectures got adopted post 1992, and PCs got adopted heavily in the early 80s when there was a recession as well. So if you think of all of these different scenarios, infrastructural shifts also have a high correlation with crises for that matter. But let me start with the three things. So I'll give one quick example on all three, right? So think of changing consumer use cases. I think what's really interesting is you're going to move to remote work, all that is fine. But what's really interesting is how can you reimagine this rather than just think of it as a channel shift? How can you reimagine work in the future and what new opportunities will that provide? And while that still sounds nebulous as a problem statement, let's take the example of Disney. That's a very real problem statement over there. It's a business that has huge IP, that has very strong characters that have a lot of resonance with the audience, but it monetizes that IP heavily through amusement parks, which are now shut down. So what would an amusement park look like in a shutdown world, right? In a lockdown world, how would you think reimagine amusement? And this is where I think of, you know, a company like Minecraft, for example, started as a virtual world, and then it became so recognizable that it's the value of the IP in that world increased beyond the technology, and that IP now gets licensed to into other amusement parks, into other game boxes. Can Disney go the other way around? Can Disney go from the real world where it has strong IP into the virtual world and create virtual worlds which compete with Minecraft, for example? So that's one example of, you know, how to think about with end user experiences being conditioned as more and more people spend more time in immersive gaming than they have ever before. Is there an opportunity for that? Now, the second point that I talked about was the value chain, right? And right now, there's a very interesting time to think about that, because if you think of movie releases, for example, or if you think of entertainment industry and the TV and movie industry in general, there are big value chain shifts that are going to happen. The most obvious is with movie releases, for example. So movies would be released to theaters, and then there would be a windowing period after which they would go into streaming distribution channels like Netflix and Amazon. But now with theaters getting closed, that windowing goes out of the window, so to speak, because the theaters lose all the negotiating leverage that they had. They had incredible negotiating leverage, which is why the studios would never want to disturb that relationship. But now studios are increasingly launching directly to consumers through streaming channels. And in China, there are platforms themselves are changing to provide a channel to movies. If you look at Huanji, which is a Chinese studio, it partnered with ByteDance. And for the first time, ByteDance went into the streaming model. So if you think of this, when we come out of a lockdown world, and if users have been sufficiently conditioned to expect movies and interact with it in new ways in a direct to stream, the value chain relationships would change, the negotiating power of the theater would have changed by then. And you can say similar things about the TV networks, right, which have long distinguished themselves on live events, on sports, concerts. All of that is going away. So now that they need content, content production has stopped because studios are not working at this point. Where do they get the content? They get it from potentially somebody like Netflix or Amazon, which then allows Netflix and Amazon to get in front of audiences that would otherwise not have thought of them. So movie value chain, you know, TV value chain, all of this is being impacted. So that's the second big thing to think about. And the third big thing to think about is really the infrastructural shift. And that is where I think the big shift is not just remote working or streaming. The big shift is to the cloud, because if you do remote working, the companies will have to move more of their processes to the cloud. And so cloud infrastructural investments are going to increase. Similarly, I believe data infrastructure investment is going to increase all the way from wireless networks down to subsea cables, because if you look at post-lockdown, Europe had to negotiate with Netflix to reduce its streaming rate because the data infrastructure was not capable of handling this level of entertainment consumption. But post-lockdown, we might be in a position where that might have to be the new normal, and so we would have to invest in that data infrastructure. So I think it comes down to thinking of change at all these three levels, and I'll just pause there if you want to dig into any of them in more detail.
Yeah, actually I want to dig on in all of them, right? But let me just summarize, right? So you have, of course, change in consumer behavior that has got suddenly accelerated
thanks to all the remote work and online education and online healthcare and everything else, right? So we'll talk about that. The second thing you said is, value chain shift, right? Which is around the example of, movies, how movies get released, how they get content gets produced, how it gets streamed, how do theaters fit in, how do content producers fit in. And lastly, the infrastructure and upstream sort of impacts, right? So let's start with the consumer first and foremost.
Right.
And in terms of, consumer behavior changing, like how does it, and I know we're going to be pontificating a little bit here and speculating, how do you reimagine businesses that fundamentally needed, physical presence, right, in a post-COVID world? So let's say going and eating in a restaurant or seeing a live theater performance, does that sort of go away, or is there like a new kind of normal? The fact that people are comfortable with streaming and watching a theater, I just watched something from the National Theatre Academy in the UK a couple of days back, and it was a phenomenal performance, but I watched it obviously on my TV. So how do you think about what will consumers be more open to, and what are things that they are implicitly more open to, but they don't know it?
Yeah. So again, at this point, we are perhaps a little early in this whole shift. So as we move forward, we'll see how it unravels. But the framework in which I would think about it is to think of both the consumer value chain, where value is being delivered to the consumer and how consumer is coming in to experience that value, as well as the upstream supply side value chain, right? So if we just take restaurants as an example, and people have stopped eating at restaurants, what exactly does that mean? This could have impact at both these levels. On the upstream side, for example, the economics of restaurants is extremely skewed by the real estate costs that they bear. If the location of a restaurant is no longer going to be an advantage, then maybe you'll have to rethink the economics. Maybe you'll have to convert restaurants into dark kitchens and give up on your prime real estate. And so we might start seeing restaurant businesses moving into dark kitchen models just because, and when I say dark kitchen, it means just a kitchen without a front end, without the restaurant experience, that is in a lower real estate or the lower rent part of town and closer to the end user, so that delivery times are also optimized. So we might see that happening, for example, if you were to look at the upstream effects. If you would look at the downstream effects of changing consumer behavior, right, at the consumer, there could be a whole range of different scenarios. Say, for example, if drive-in it becomes important, this is something we were talking about yesterday, the interface, that the drive-in interface, as you mentioned, would become a very important point of innovation. And the conversion funnel at that point, how do you optimize the drive-in experience for maximum conversion, best turnaround? That starts becoming important. Then that would be where we would start seeing innovation happen. We would see restaurants innovate over there, but more importantly, we would see cross-industry innovation either by tool providers who provide that whole experience as a service, or by aggregators who aggregate data from the drive-in experience to create new platform-based business models around it that could come in. And so, those are some of the ways in which we could start seeing change coming in with changing consumer behavior. So that's the broad framework.
Yeah, so let's talk about upstream impacts, right? In your blog post, you mentioned companies like Microsoft and Amazon really doing well through this downturn, particularly with respect to the infrastructure shifts that are going to happen, right? Like a lot more now, people have been using cloud technologies for a while, not just at a consumer, but at a business level. But that rate of pace of change is going to get rapidly accelerated, right? So it's not just the application like a Zoom or a Netflix or whatever on top of it, but really the shift to cloud will become much more accelerated.
So I think the shift to cloud will become accelerated as a function of multiple things. The first is that, a shift in the enterprise is also fundamentally end-user driven. So if end-users demand something, it's just like the bring your own device, BYOD days when BlackBerries were taken out and we saw everything being replaced by iPhones. When you start seeing that happen, the purchasing parameters change, your purchasing department is not involved, and so a lot of different new kinds of workflows start getting implemented, new kinds of technology providers start coming in as well. So there's definitely an upside for, I would think, Microsoft, Amazon, and the others who are in the cloud business, but there's also a big potential opportunity to enter the enterprise space at this point where the decision maker for the purchases is going to shift. So that's also going to be an important shift. Similarly, we'll have infrastructural needs that are going to be required for these new consumer use cases, which are away from the enterprise. So let's say streaming is on the rise. There's going to be more need for video compression technologies. There's going to, and with the remote work being on the rise, there's going to be more need for encryption technology. So these are all infrastructural shifts that are bound to happen, that are waiting to happen, and crisis like this and the shift in consumer behavior totally escalates this. So in terms of a bet, I find it a much safer bet to bet on the infrastructure, because you're providing the picks and shovels for the gold rush rather than the gold diggers themselves, which are the services on top of it. So that's why I would go long on Google or an Amazon or a Microsoft with their cloud capabilities at this point.
Wonderful. So switching gears a little bit, let's talk about government and the role of regulation and, policy and policy frameworks, right? In terms of how do you think that is going to get impacted, right? Because the government is, even in India, has had to kind of double down on adopting technology, on figuring out how to kind of get the country going in this time. So maybe talk a little bit about, I know you work a lot more with clients in Europe and the US, but just the role of government, the role of regulation, etc. That will be helpful.
Yeah, for sure. So I think it's a super interesting time for multiple reasons. The first is that governments are, even before we get to regulation, governments are providing big stimulus packages. But at the same time, we are beginning to see the role that platforms play, because platforms are having to provide big stimulus packages as well in their own ways, because platforms are market makers, much like the government is. And if you look at what Airbnb, for example, is doing, it's provided this whole package for hosts who are going through this crisis. There's going to be, monetary help for them. Airbnb on its own is not in a good position. It had to take a down round at a very high interest rate, 11 to 12%. But it still has to, in order to protect and sustain its ecosystem and not end up with mass foreclosures, it has to provide this kind of a package. And we've seen something similar with the restaurant industry as well, right? With Zomato, for example, in India, running a campaign to help restaurants, Yelp and OpenTable trying to do their part for restaurants. So the first piece that I see that's really going to take shape is that when platforms realize how much they need the ecosystem, they're going to start acting more like custodians of the ecosystem, because without the ecosystem, the platform does not survive in these cases. So this is something we've not seen to the same extent in the past. We're going to see that happen much more through the crisis. And then when the ecosystem gets conditioned, beyond it as well. So that's one big shift, right? The second big shift that is there is just how the narrative around big tech has changed. That has changed quite a bit, because over the last, I would say 2010 to 2015, it was all about, or 2005 to 2013 or so, it was all about the upstarts beating the giants and Facebook and the young companies coming up. And then 2013, tipping point was around Brexit, Trump election. 2014 onwards, 2016 onwards, the narrative started moving against platforms. And because also platforms became really big and started exploiting the ecosystem, what's happened is that all this narrative, if you just do a date-bound Google search for big tech regulation, you'll see that this kind of hit a peak towards the latter half, last quarter of 2019. And 2020 was supposed to be the big year that the big four tech companies, big five tech companies would be regulated, especially Google, Facebook, and Amazon. What's happened is quite the contrary, because big tech has stepped up and is now playing a massive role in helping governments solve this current crisis. And so for the world right now, the current crisis is so much bigger that everybody is willing to forget all this regulation. And in the process, we're going to start seeing regulation actually move in a direction that might favor the big tech as well. We're in a situation right now where we don't have a playbook to get out of lockdown to a full service economy. The only playbook we've seen is China, where data harvesting is required, data privacy is thrown to the dogs in order to get the economy working again. And if that is how you get the economy back on its feet, then that legitimizes your data collection, that takes data privacy away from the equation, and that would then start leading to deregulation of data to a much bigger degree in Western democracies as well. And we might well say that this is all towards a humanitarian cause, but regulation is, a policy making is complex. You can't create very strict boundaries. So as long as there's a reason to deregulate data, there'll be a way to make that work for capitalism as well. And so we'll kind of move in the other direction in the coming days is what I really feel at this point.
Sounds great. I wanted to build on a couple of points that you said there, right? In fact, I'm looking at your platform manifesto, which you had out in 2015, 2016. So you said two things there. One is that the ecosystem is the new supply chain, right? And liquidity management is the new inventory control. And so the points you make about whether it's Airbnb and their hosts and making them kind of stay alive, or whether it is Zomato with the restaurants, or anybody which sort of is got a multi-sided marketplace or even a two-sided marketplace, right? I think it was all the rage to say, hey, look, Airbnb is the biggest, you know, hotel chain with no hotels or no hotel rooms or no capital infrastructure. But like, you know, it's sort of coming back full circle in some sense. How do you think about that, right? That a lot of these folks that were pure tech companies, marketplaces with a, you know, strong network layer, strong data layer, perhaps even a strong tech layer, they do need to have the underlying nodes of the network be healthy for their business to be viable.
There are two parts to it. There's certainly this part that you talk about right now, which is you need to manage for resilience, not just for scale, right? Because you don't want to just keep moving fast and breaking things. You want it to really be sustainable as well. So that's one part of it. And I'll come back to that shortly. The other part of it is what would have happened even despite COVID-19, what was already happening even despite the crisis. And the other part of it is this, that a lack of asset ownership is not the success criterion for a platform business. It just so happens that platforms leverage third-party assets. That's all. That's how they scale. That's how they don't need to scale on the supply side and yet benefit from returns, massive returns. But what we repeatedly see is that success in a platform business is not in lack of asset ownership, but in strategic asset ownership. So what essentially platform businesses do is they allow the ecosystem to take the risk of asset ownership. And once the merchants or the content providers or any kind of producer in the ecosystem has proven a sustainable business model in a certain niche in the ecosystem, the platform enters in and starts owning the inventory over there. So many examples of this, think of Amazon. The moment a merchant starts doing better, Amazon goes in as a retailer in that category and pushes the merchant out. And if you think of the whole model of Netflix and Amazon Prime, all of it is based on studios taking the risk. You know, studios work like venture capital. They take big risks. They don't know what's going to happen. And some, you know, few succeed, most fail. Few creations succeed, most fail, right? But all the risk is taken by studios, and Netflix and Amazon Prime gather the data of the end consumer and then inform their own data-driven content creation, which then ensures that they don't have to go through the same risk-taking model again. And that's when owning the inventory makes sense. So my point is, the first part of it, COVID-19 or no COVID-19, it always makes sense for the platform to own the most lucrative parts of the inventory. There is no badge of honor in saying that we don't own the inventory. The only reason you don't own the inventory is two reasons, actually. The first reason is you want somebody else to take the risk, and once they've proven it, you then swoop in. The second is that you don't want to own the inventory in less profitable categories. Let others do that. That's what Amazon does. That's what Netflix does, if you really think of it now. The second piece is the post-COVID-19 reality, right? And this is where I believe that resilience is going to be more important than just the economics of scale. You need to have a resilient ecosystem. You need to have a resilient supply chain. Platform or not, you need to own the critical nodes. And so that part is going to be increasingly important. What I believe, though, is going to happen, and this is where, again, I would, you know, go bullish on Amazon, for example. What I believe is going to happen is the longer this lockdown lasts, the more difficult it is going to be for companies to over-invest in resilience. Most companies will be just in survival mode. And during this period, the companies that will over-invest to create resilience, and Amazon has perfected the playbook, it over-invests in technology, in warehousing and logistics, and then uses it internally, but then also opens it to third parties. So this is an opportunity for somebody like Amazon to over-invest in various parts of logistics, various parts of even healthcare logistics at this point in time, and then provide it as a service, create the AWS for healthcare, for example, create that as a service model, which then survives this period and continues. So I would expect that there would be a lot of scale players who will emerge, who over-invest on the supply side and then provide it as a service, and that allows them to win big in the post-COVID world.
Wonderful, Sangeet. This is really fascinating. I feel we could go on for hours. Maybe we'll do another one in a few months or whatever as this thing unfolds. Before we wrap up here, I know you're doing some amazing work in terms of opening your own platform, no pun intended there, and you have a new site that you're planning called platform.institute. Can you talk a little bit about that, in particular, both for startups as well as for larger companies?
My goal over there was actually to essentially democratize the workshop that I, or the masterclass that I provide to corporates, right? And so the starting point of that was to convert it into an online masterclass that is self-serve, that can be used by startups to upskill and understand platform strategy in detail, and can be used even by enterprises to think about how to reinvent their business model. So that's what's launched right now at platform.institute, which is this whole masterclass available online. But in the coming weeks and months, it's going to be expanded even further, where a third party, for example, can use this curriculum and run their own workshops, but keep this as the backbone. Somebody who's certified and well positioned to run it can keep this as the backbone of the workshop and help a company, you know, build a platform. And similarly, even for startups, there's going to be a constantly updated set of content on this program, where as we move forward and as platforms evolve, the content will keep on changing and will keep on evolving as we move forward.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Sangeet. This has been really exciting. I strongly encourage our audience to go check out platform.institute. And if you haven't read one of his earlier books, please read those. There's some very nice articles in HBR as well. So thanks again for being on the Prime Venture Partners podcast, Sangeet. Great to have you.
Thank you, Amit. Really enjoyed it. Thank you.
Dear listeners, thank you for listening to this episode of the podcast. Subscribe now on your favorite podcast app for free, and you'll be the first one to know when new episodes are available. Just search for Prime Venture Partners podcast in Apple Podcast, Spotify, Castbox, or however you get your podcasts. Then hit subscribe. And if you have enjoyed the show, we would be really grateful if you leave us a review on Apple Podcast. To read the full transcript, find the link in the show notes.